Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us. I'm Tom Wolf, and I'm a trustee with Tree Fund. And Tree Fund is a unique and interesting organization, and what makes it great, and I'm going off script a little bit, but we have an executive director that's just great to work with. I'm involved with the Tree Fund on several different committees, the finance committee, the governance committee, and also help plan the tour to trees, which will be in my home state, leaving out of Nashville, Tennessee this year, and riding up through Kentucky. So we welcome any of you that would like to ride a bicycle for 5 days. Will be interesting. Tree Fund was established in 2002 with the mission to support scientific discovery and dissemination of new knowledge in the fields of arboriculture and urban forestry. It's a mouthful. Tree Fund advances its mission by issuing research grants, and those grants are primarily applied to research in how to better plant, propagate, and care for urban trees. So we're not we don't fund forest research, it's all urban tree research. Tree Fund provides scholarships to students in arboriculture, urban forestry, horticulture, and related fields. And we fund education for kids in K through 12 related to trees and environmental stewardship. That's the neat part. Since 2002, Tree Fund has awarded grants amounting to almost $4 million, which is a pretty good, I think we're the largest grant-making organization of our kind. So how does Tree Fund raise money? It comes from individual donors, endowment earnings, partnerships, community engagement events, and legacy giving, which is, we have a heritage oak society that for larger donors, a good way to support the industry that many of us are involved with. The areas that Tree Fund works in: root and soil management, plant health care, urban forestry, technology transfer, risk assessment and worker safety, propagation, planting, and establishment. We have several research grant lines at a variety of funding levels throughout the year, and you can find information about all of those, including the application periods, on our website at treefund.org. And we're excited to offer two new research grants in 2019, and one will be the Sierra Fund, which supports projects which will help arborists and urban foresters communicate the value of trees and urban forests on a national basis through technology transfer and engagement with developers, builders, civil engineers, and city planners. Other new fund for 2019 is the Barberinas Fund, and it will support projects that are somewhat nursery-based, focused on tree planting and transplantation techniques, and the improvement of tree varieties for urban conditions, to include investigations to root and soil sciences. We have five scholarship lines available, and amounts have increased to the $3,000 to $5,000 range. Ohio Chapter ISA Education Grant will be our only education grant in 2019. And all education grants and scholarship recipients will be announced coming up in June. To see all the research that we've funded throughout the years, if you're interested in history going back to 2002, I'd encourage you to go to the research archives pages of our website, and you can search by keyword or scientist name. And we've compiled some lists, or a list of research projects by topic. And after exploring the archives, you can also find other information that's useful about Tree Fund on the website, including the upcoming webinar schedule and info on events like the Tour to Trees. So without further ado, I want to introduce our speaker, presenter for today. Dr. Dan Herms is Vice President of Research and Development for Davey. And before joining Davey, Dan was a professor of in the Department of Entomology at Ohio State University from 1997 to 2017. And he received his bachelor's in landscape horticulture from Ohio State University in 1982, a master's in both horticulture and entomology, also from Ohio State in 1984, and a PhD from Michigan State University in forest entomology, go Spartans, in 1991. His research and outreach programs are focused on the ecology and management of insect pests of trees in forests, urban forest, and ornamental landscapes. So let's welcome Dr. Dan Herms. Thank you.
Okay. So, all right. Well, I've conducted research on emerald ash borer since just about the time it was discovered in the United States and Canada in 2002. And I want to talk about that work today. And of course, emerald ash borer is an exotic wood boring insect, as you well know, native to East Asia, established in many areas of North America. It's a metallic wood boring insect. You can see where it gets the name. The larvae are flat headed borers, very flat insects. Emerald ash borer is very closely related to the bronze birch borer and the two-lined chestnut borer. So if you're familiar with the ecology and management of those two species, it certainly has provided kind of an advantage towards understanding emerald ash borer. Very similar life cycles, very similar ecology, with one major distinction, and that is that emerald ash borer kills healthy trees, whereas our native borers are restricted to colonizing and killing severely stressed, highly weakened trees. So the larvae feed underneath the bark on the phloem and scarring the xylem tissue, as you can see here in the cambial region, which disrupts translocation of water and nutrients. All major ash species, well, all ash species in North America that emerald ash borer has encountered so far are susceptible. We know that Oregon ash is also susceptible. And white fringe tree has, in the last few years, turned out to also be a suitable host for emerald ash borer. As I mentioned, healthy trees are killed. Trees usually die within 1 to 3 years of showing first symptoms, and they may be infested for a couple years before the symptoms become apparent. And they kill trees of all size, so they can kill small saplings up to the largest mature trees. So here you can see scenes of emerald ash borer, ash mortality in all environments in which ash trees occur. The life cycle is a 1 or 2 year life cycle. So the typical life cycle was 1 year, very similar, as I mentioned, to bronze birch borer, two-lined chestnut borer. The adults begin emerging in Ohio and Michigan in late May to June. Farther south, they can emerge in early May, probably even late April. The adults feed on foliage. They have to feed for a short time, a week to 2 weeks, before they're reproductively mature, lay eggs on the bark. The larvae chew their way through the bark, enter the tree, and begin feeding during the summer in the vascular tissue. If they complete the fourth instar, then they'll overwinter as pre-pupae. And here this shows a cross-section of bark. They'll construct a pupal chamber in the outer bark or just in the very shallow area of the sapwood, the pupate the following spring. Now, in colder climates where degree days are more limited, or in healthy trees where they can still mount some level of defense, the larvae grow slower. And if they don't reach the fourth instar by the end of the summer into early fall, they'll overwinter as earlier instars, second or third instars, and complete their development the following spring. And this leads to a 2 year life cycle, because once they reach that fourth instar in the prepupal stage, they have to overwinter before they can emerge. And so they all pupate at the same time, whether it's a 1 year life cycle or a 2 year life cycle. And when infestations are in the earliest stages, many, or if not most, of the insects will experience 2 year life cycles because of the slow growth in the healthy trees. And the populations will grow much slower with a 2 year life cycle than a 1 year life cycle. So early on, infestations build slower, and then that accelerates as more and more trees become infested with larger number of insects. As I said, adults feed on the foliage. They nibble around the margins, It's not significant defoliation, but they have to do that before they become reproductively mature. This shows the current distribution of emerald ash borer, at least as of September 2018, slightly out of date now. I believe the number of states is up to 35 or 36. Colorado is still the farthest west infestation, but you see inroads here, Oklahoma, Kansas, Nebraska, South Dakota, moving down into Georgia, Alabama. It'll be interesting to see how far south EAB can move, because the pre-pupae seem to require cold temperatures before they will pupate. And unless they can overcome that barrier through genetic variation or mutation, that need for cold temperatures prior to pupation could provide a southern limit. And the northern limits can be imposed by cold temperatures during the winter, which can cause mortality when it gets down to minus 25, minus 30 degrees Fahrenheit. This just shows the distribution of EAB overlaid on the distribution of major ash species. And we know all the eastern species are susceptible. We know Oregon ash is susceptible from common garden studies. We don't know about some of these other species in the southwestern U.S. Yet. But you can see that we're really still in the early stages of infestation. The major core of mortality is kind of concentrated in this area in the Midwest, Ohio, Indiana, Michigan, obviously, and then in areas where EAB has been established for a while. But in many of these other areas, populations are still really low. And we are very much still in the early stages of the invasion of North America by EAB. These outlier infestations, Colorado, other places, obviously the movement of infested wood, could be firewood, nursery trees. These were the source of the infestation in Columbus, Ohio, discovered back in 2004. These trees were shipped prior to the discovery of EAB. Logs, it's a sawmill factory, imported ash logs. So hopefully this kind of movement has slowed because of public education and quarantines. The natural infestation is not extremely fast, especially when populations are young. They're growing slow with the two-year life cycle. Studies have shown that they'll spread less than a half mile a year, but as with any invasive species, as the population gets larger, the rate of infestation will spread rapidly. And as it was spreading out of Michigan into Ohio, the wave of ash mortality was spreading about 15 miles per year. So once the population gets, you know, really high, EAB can fly. They're strong flyers. They can fly a long way. And when the population gets really high, even rare events become commonplace and populations spread faster as they get larger. In terms of symptoms, dieback and decline, of course. So one of the characteristics is the thinning of the canopy, not necessarily top-down dieback. Here you see the canopy thinning. There's still foliage throughout the canopy, but it gets sparser and sparser. Epicormic branching, suckering from the roots are all common symptoms. But this thinning is pretty characteristic. You can develop a search image for that. Other signs, of course, the D-shaped exit holes are very characteristically D-shaped. Galleries just under the bark, they're larvae just under the bark, and this tapeworm-like segmentation. So woodpeckers are very good early warning symptoms. So they'll EAB attacks a healthy tree first in the upper canopy. They seem to prefer about 4-inch DBH branches and trunks. And so they'll colonize the upper canopy, and you may see woodpecker activity while the tree still looks healthy. And woodpeckers are very good early warning. You can see the flashing here of the bark, these woodpecker holes. They're not hunting randomly. If you spray paint over these holes and then chip the bark off, you'll see that they terminate in a larval gallery in a pupal chamber. They're overwintering in this outer bark. You can see this pileated woodpecker extracting a larva, a prepupal larva, But because they're so shallow, they're accessible even to the smaller species, the downy woodpecker, hairy woodpeckers, etc. Here you can see extreme woodpecker activity. But you can look, and if you see a woodpecker in the upper canopy on a healthy ash, I'd be very suspicious. I have not seen woodpeckers working on healthy ash trees in the absence of EAB. Other early warning signs, symptoms are this bark splitting. And so a healthy tree here, you can see a D-shaped exit hole. This bark splitting occurs when the tree is still healthy. When it's colonized, the tree will form wound periderm tissue under the bark, callus tissue. And as that grows, that swelling can split the bark. And here you see an older infestation. You can look through the window and see the gallery underneath that. And if the tree is treated with an insecticide or, you know, can otherwise recover, well, that would really be the only reason it would recover pretty much, is a result of this wound periderm reestablishing. Here you can see some callus tissue reestablishing vascular integrity and compartmentalizing the gallery. So there are native borers in the eastern United States and in the plains area. The banded ash clearwing borer is a common pest of stressed trees, other clearwing borers, round-headed borers, red-headed ash borer, et cetera. On dying and dead trees and bark beetles on decrepit trees. So really in a tree that has viability, clearwing borers or EAB are the two primary options. The clearwing borers are moths. They make these round exit holes. Their galleries extend into the tree. You can snake a wire into the tree through that hole, whereas the EAB gallery is just right under the bark. The clearwing borers expel frass. You can see some frass clinging to the tree. They're expelling it from their galleries. Here it's accumulating in an extreme case on the bark mulch. Here you can see some clearwing exit holes. So native borers are an issue and can lead to the suspicion and even wild goose chases. Here's a comparison of the exit holes, the D-shaped EAB hole, the larger round banded ash clearwing exit hole, the larger oval red-headed ash borer exit hole also extends into the tree, whereas the EAB exit hole does not. Here's just some scenes of the red-headed ash borer and the decrepit eastern ash bark beetle that infest decrepit ash trees. So ash can die, as I said, rapidly once they begin expressing symptoms. So here's a street in Toledo in June of 2006. Here's the same street, the same image. Here's a tree in 2006. Here's the same tree 3 years later. And so once the populations build, the trees die quite rapidly in the urban forest. We studied patterns of ash mortality in the forest near the epicenter in southeast Michigan. How fast do the trees die? How fast do infestations build and so forth? So we worked in this forested area of southeast Michigan in this watershed, the Upper Huron River, if you're familiar with southeast Michigan, established a number of, we worked in 38 stands with three plots per stand. So that adds up to, I think, 114. And across a gradient of upland white ash forest into riparian green ash and swamp black ash. And what we found is that when we started 2004 and in 2005, mortality was 40%, but by 2008 was up to over 95%. So in just 3 years, we saw this increase in mortality. Over half of the trees died in this three-year period. By 2009, up to 99.7% trees greater than 2.5 centimeters DBH, so saplings greater than 1 inch, anything big enough to be physically infested. And this little drop in mortality is a result of these saplings entering the 2.5 centimeter size class, and so increasing the number of living trees. So mortality happens really fast once it builds up, but it takes it a while to build up. We did some dendrochronology studies, tree ring analysis of dead ash trees, and found that they were dying as early as 1994 in these forests. So it was again discovered in 2002. So it took, you know, at least 10 years to 2004 to get to 35%, 2005 to get to 40%. But then again, only 3 years to get up to 95%. And similar patterns have been seen in the urban forest. So this exponential increase in ash mortality suggests that it can really get ahead of you if you don't plan. Things start out slow. If this was, for example, a city, populations get detected through trapping now when they typically are very small, and then nothing happens for a while. People get complacent, the press stops reporting about it, get this lag like you do with any invasive species, and then boom, explosion. And the tree mortality can really get ahead of the capacity of a municipal forestry department to remove those trees. And so it requires, you know, preemptive planning in terms of, you know, how it's going to be managed once the trees really begin to die rapidly. Just a word about the classical biological control program. The USDA, APHIS, and the Forest Service has released four natural enemies that are native to Asia into North America. Three, these are parasitic wasps. They're non-stinging, they don't sting humans. Three that are larval parasitoids. And so here you can see, here's the ovipositor of this female inserted into the tree through the bark. And she lays her eggs on the larvae. Now this parasitoid is only effective on younger trees with thin bark, which is kind of a problem. Here's a parasitoid that lays its egg. It's an egg parasitoid in the, this is an EAB egg. She lays her egg here. And these eggs are on the surface. So even on mature trees, they can be vulnerable to this parasitoid. Two of these spathious species, this particular species is the most recently introduced, more effective in northern habitats where the winters are colder, and this one more effective in southern habitats. So hopefully the combination of this will have an impact. They don't seem to be doing much to stop the spread or the impact, but where they may be more, have a greater impact is on what we call this orphaned cohort. So these seedlings and saplings that are too small to be infested when all the ash trees die, when the population crashes, when the EAB population crashes because the large ash trees have died and their carrying capacity has declined, then maybe the parasitoids can help regulate that EAB population at low levels and allow these seedlings to mature to the point where they can maybe reproduce. And these seedlings can grow really slow in the shade. For example, this is a plant that we tagged in 2009, and then we took this picture in 2016, and it had grown less than a quarter of an inch during that period of time. So they'll just kind of lurk for long periods of time in the shade until they're released by gaps formed, for example, by EAB mortality. And maybe these parasitoids have evolved in Asia under conditions where EAB populations are naturally all very low. And so maybe they'll be more effective on low density populations with this orphan cohort. Just a little bit about ash trees. When they die, they become brittle and they snap. They don't stand as snags for long periods of time. This is a large, about a 40 inch ash tree that has snapped. Here you can see trees that will snap. Here's one that's beginning to snap. This can create quite a hazard in the urban environment. So these trees, you know, aren't going to stand. And if they are allowed to stand, they're going to fall on cars, on houses, on utility lines, become a hazard, it'll be a fire hazard, and so forth. And we've looked at how fast they die. And this is, we looked at the percentage of trees that have fallen in once the stand reaches 90% mortality, which was 3 years after 40% mortality. And so here, you know, 2 years after they got to that stage, you have anywhere from, you know, 5 to 20% of the trees have fallen. 7 years later, you have 20 to percent of the trees have fallen. So they don't stand very long before they begin falling and start becoming a hazard. They become brittle, again, dangerous to climb, dangerous to remove. So EAB management can really be broken down into just a few categories of options, but these options can be integrated in pretty sophisticated ways, as I'll describe. Of course, you can do nothing and let nature take its course, as we saw in that natural area where the trees are, will just fall and enter the ecosystem as downed, coarse woody debris. Can move and replace trees. This can be done proactively or preemptively. Tree inventories are really critical, so you can start planning which trees. I mean, there may be ash trees that are just out of place because they're declining already or they're interfering with utilities lines. They may not be candidates for protection. Can start removing trees on a schedule that is compatible with the budget and staffing capacity and so forth. Sustained insecticide treatments are an option. You can protect trees, as we'll see, quite effectively, even during peak outbreak. And increasingly, communities are integrating various options, and I'll talk about that. So we've done a number of studies to study systemic insecticides for control of EAB, looking at multi-year evaluations on street trees. We've looked at systemic insecticides, including soil treatments with things like, imidacloprid, dinotefuran, so systemic neonicotinoid products that can be applied as a soil treatment, or in the case of dinotefuran, a basal bark spray, and then trunk injections, various imidacloprid products, emamectin benzoate, azadiractin, are systemic trunk injected products that are available. And of course, there's various pros and cons of trunk versus soil treatments. I won't read through all of these, but trunk injections have certain advantages, including some of the products are more effective on larger trees. They have faster uptake. Some disadvantages is that the rate of uptake can be slow if it's cloudy or if the ground is dry or in the middle of the hot afternoon. The distribution may not be uniform due to location of injection ports and sites, and also things like branch inclusions, architecture, and so forth. And of course, there's the wounding issue. I'll talk a little bit more about that. Soil treatments, non-invasive, more uniform distribution when it's being taken up naturally through the roots, can be applied under adverse environmental conditions and a greater timing of the timing window, including the dormant season, although not quite as effective as we'll see. But you don't know how much is being taken up and so forth. So questions that we've addressed in our research is studies with larger trees. Initial studies were typically done with small trees. We've worked with 20, 25, up to 50-inch trees. Now, optimal application rates, fall treatments with soil treatments, and residual activity, two-year control, three-year control, et cetera, and then head-to-head comparisons. And most of the studies we've done were multi-year studies. We didn't remove the trees. We looked at canopy decline or lack thereof, which is the objective of the treatment, to protect the canopy, maintain the canopy. And so we use this rating scale that Dave Snitley published, this 10-point rating scale to look at decline. And again, I'll emphasize, again, this thinning of the canopy versus top-down dieback. So here you can see, healthy ash, if you look up through the canopy, you really don't see any sky through a full canopy. But then it begins to thin, the leaves get smaller, sparser, fewer leaves. Here's this is a common level of stress associated with drought. Trees can move back and forth between these categories from one year to the next. Here you start seeing trees becoming more chlorotic, thinning of the canopy. Here you have extreme canopy thinning. sparse canopy, small leaves, yellowing, chlorotic, and then ultimately the death of the tree. Trees usually go from here to here within 1 year. A tree looks like this in the late summer. It's going to typically look like this the following spring. We also evaluate the trees by looking at exit holes. So if you prune a branch in the spring, say before adults begin emerging in late May, any exit holes present would have been formed the following year and represent larvae that colonized the tree 2 years before that. Then we circle these holes or mark them with paint, and then any new holes that are formed would be larvae that colonized the tree the previous year and then just recently emerged. So again, here you can see the canopy decline versus a healthy treated tree. So the first study I want to talk about is imidacloprid soil drenches, and we were tested different rates. So the 1x rate was at the time the maximum rate for EAB, and is still the maximum rate for most pest species.
Hey Dan, I'm gonna interrupt you just for a quick second. Anybody's having a hard time seeing Dan's slides, just double click on his slideshow and that will maximize the view. Some people were saying your face was big and then your slides were a little smaller. So just double click on his slideshow and that should maximize the view. All right, go ahead.
Yeah, okay, yeah, that's a good thing to fix. The last thing we need is my big face and my little slides. So. Yeah, I don't know how to adjust that, so thanks.
No, we're all good. We're all good. Thanks a lot.
Yep, thank you. So the 1x rate, then the 2x rate, which is now labeled for ash trees greater than 15 inches, 15 inches or greater DBH. And then we also compared spring versus fall. So this would be early to mid-May. This would be October timing. Soil drench, we just mix it in a bucket and pour it right at the base of the trunk where there's a high density of roots. Here's our study site. So these trees are 15 to 22 inch trees. And we started treating these trees in spring of 2006 and continued through 2013. We treated the trees every year. They were treated either in the fall or in the spring, not both. And what we see, the white line is the untreated trees, and can see in 2006, all the points are superimposed. None of the trees are showing any canopy decline. 2007, and starting to see a little bit of what seems to be canopy decline. And then you can see how rapidly the untreated trees declined within 2 years up to 100%. This is fall, treating in the fall at the 1x rate. Not as effective as treating in the fall in the spring with the 1x rate. So the 1x rate in the fall became unacceptable to the city of Toledo and they removed the trees. That's why that line truncates. But here, where we treated with the 1x in the spring, the 2x in the spring, or the 2x in the fall, we see that all provided good control, a little bit more canopy thinning here. This was associated with a drought year as well, but really good control. And this is carrying through kind of this peak period of outbreak and then on through that. So here, 2006, here in 2009, you can see trees that are treated with an effective treatment, 2x in the fall or 1x in the spring, 1x in the fall. The difference between the 1x and the 2x in the fall, so 1x in the fall versus 2x in the fall, indicates that you need a higher rate to get the equivalent control if you're treating in the fall, which also means that all things equal, it's more effective to treat in the spring. And so what I like to say is it's better to store the product in the bottle during the winter time than in the soil, because when you're treating in the fall, which has some logistical advantages for timing and so forth, you're really treating for insects that will be feeding on the tree the following June, July, and August. So you're treating really 9 months ahead of time, and it's just not as effective, all things equal. The fact that the 1x spring and the 2x spring were equally as effective means that the 2x rate on these 15 to 20 inch, 16 to 23 inch trees is kind of overkill. And that although we haven't tested the 2x rate on larger trees, that it would suggest that the 2x rate would be effective on trees that are even larger than 23 inches DBH. So what about implications for long-term management of emerald ash borer? Can we reduce treatment intensity after we kind of get through the big peak and most of the other trees in the city have died? This was the situation in Toledo, 2011, 2012. Most of the ash trees were dead. These are pretty much the only trees, large trees left in the city that were these trees and others that had been treated. And so could we start dialing back the intensity of the treatments? In 2012, we started a regimen where we treated two-thirds of the trees in this population on a rotating basis, which means that over this three-year period, every tree was treated twice. So this is an opportunity to reduce the cost of treating and so forth, and then thinking that we could, monitor and see if the population started to build up. Most of the trees are treated. The untreated trees in that particular year could get some associational protection, because when adults feed on these leaves of the treated trees, they would be impacted as well. So that associational protection may be a part of the story. And then in 2015, we just stopped treating altogether to see how long we could go and just monitor and see if we could then resume treatments if we started to see infestations again. And unfortunately, the results weren't that promising. So we stopped treating. 2014 was the last year of treatment. And by August 2016, the trees were starting to decline. So apparently these untreated trees just became a magnet for every emerald ash borer adult that was left in the vicinity. So we don't know when you can stop treating yet. It's just, even in Toledo, it's still too early to say. As far as placement with the imidacloprid, we recommend that it be applied right at the base of the trunk. You can see there's a high density of feeder roots. On large trees, the product can probably penetrate the epidermis on the roots, and studies by USDA APHIS has shown that treating right at the base results in higher residual levels in the tree than if you treat out to the drip line. And you can see the tree, these roots diverge like spokes on a wheel. And if you start moving out towards the drip line, in lots of areas where there'll be no roots and just wasted product. So trunk injections, emamectin benzoate. At the time we were doing the study, triage was the only product. Now there are there's arvermectin, and there's another product coming out as well, and the name of that is escaping me at the moment. But in this study, we looked at the duration of control. So we treated the trees once in 2006 and then monitored them over time to see how many years of residual control that we would get. We looked at, if you're familiar with the triage label, a range of rates. So we looked at the low up to the medium high rate, and we actually even looked at the high rate, 0.8, but it was kind of hard to get that full amount into the tree, and as you'll see, you don't need to go that high. And what we found was that we applied these treatments in June of 2006, and then we evaluated them in August of 2006, August of 2007, August of 2008, so still getting 3 years of control. In the fourth year, the control starting to break down, but 3 years of control with the emamectin benzoate, and multi-year control. Again, you can see how rapidly the untreated trees are declining. You go out 3 years, and then you see the trees that had been treated now declining as fast too, but 3 years of control. These are exit hole data from the branches. So after 2 years and after 3 years, starting to see some infestation. So treated in June of 2006. So these exit holes formed in 2009 would have been larvae infesting the tree in 2008. So if you treat every 2 to 3 years, get really good control. So here's the study site in 2006, 2009. So they were only treated once. And so in 2009, you can see the treated versus the untreated trees. So if you treat again in 2009, you could maintain this control quite well. Here's another study we did. These were with smaller trees where we treated in May of 2012 and then we evaluated them 3 years later, 2012, 2013, 2014. So at the end of the 2014 season, what we found is that the triage and the arbormectin, which is another emamectin benzoate formulation, both really good control. Imidacloprid, we've known from other studies that you have to treat every year with imidacloprid. And so obviously after end of the third year, you're not getting control with that. So wounding, one of the disadvantages of trunk injections is that they can create wounds. So the tree IV system uses these arbor plugs. There are systems now where you don't have to insert the plastic plug to make the injection. The wedgel, little needle that you insert in there, but it can push the pressure can cause the bark to balloon out, bubble out. And so here you can see some splitting from that and wounds, residual wounds from the previous year's treatment of the wedgel. So these wounding can be a concern with the trunk injections. I'll come back to that. That slide's out of order. I apologize. So we also tried safari dinotefuran trials. So we compared applying safari or dinotefuran. There's other formulations of dinotefuran as well as a soil treatment. Here we're making a soil injection to get it below the mulch versus a basal bark spray. You spray the lower 6 feet of the trunk with the recommended amount based on the DBH, and it moves, it's very soluble, moves through the bark, and then is translocated up the canopy. You do not need to use an adjuvant with it. You can apply it just strictly, just the insecticide alone. And what we found is that both methods were equally effective on these trees. So here's canopy decline, here's the untreated. Here is the basal trunk spray versus soil injection. We did find that there's a rate effect. So the high rate was more effective than this lower rate. Same with the soil injection with these neonicotinoids. We recommend that you use the highest labeled rate for that size of tree. It's a little different from the triage. I didn't emphasize that point, but even the low rate was very effective for 3 years on the triage. You do not need to use the highest rate with triage, but with these neonicotinoids, we recommend the highest rate. So no difference between those two application methods. In this trial, we compared three different commonly used approaches. So pointer is imidacloprid that's formulated for use with the wedgel. Triage, we used at the medium rate, emamectin benzoate, the tree IV system, and then imidacloprid soil drench at the highest rate, either the 1x or 2x, depending on whether the tree is greater or less than 15 inches DBH. Here's our study site. These trees are showing about 20% decline even before EAB, typical parking lot scenario. And the imidacloprid treatments we applied every year. The triage treatment we just applied once and then evaluated these treatments in 2011 and 2012. And what we found is that the triage was effective, kept the trees. So at the beginning of the study, here's the trees are all kind of here in this 20 to 30% range. The triage trees maintained stable at that kind of level. So did the imidacloprid soil drench. The pointer was less effective, no different than the control as the trees decline. And this is just a, not applying enough active ingredient. If you do the math, I think there's, you're applying less product and just wasn't holding up as well. Here's a study that Deb McCullough at Michigan State University just recently published a couple months ago, where she was looking at multi-year studies, treating trees every year or every 2 years or every 3 years, and comparing dinotefuran, this is the basal trunk spray, emamectin benzoate, the high rate, emamectin benzoate at a low rate, and then emicide, which is an imidacloprid trunk injection capsule. And so here, this is if you treat the trees every 2 years, emamectin benzoate, very effective. Even these other products reduced, not statistically significantly, but consistently had less in larvae. This is the number of larvae per meter squared. This is not canopy decline. So the emamectin benzoate had significantly lower larvae when treated every 2 years. When treated every 3 years, emamectin benzoate also very good control, whereas the others were not different. So here, if you look, this black bar is trees that are treated every year. And so dinotefuran, very effective when used every year. But if you skip a year, or if you skip 2 years, it becomes much less effective. And the emicide also becomes less effective. But this is there's now 4 or 5 published studies showing that emamectin benzoate provides 3 years of control. Here's a study we did with really big trees. And I want to call out Al Schock with the Edwards Tree Service and Ohio arborist that collaborated with me on this study. Here's an ash tree that was, ash tree that was treated, and some untreated trees here. Another ash tree that was treated. So these trees ranged at the beginning up to 47 inches. We carried this study out. We treated these trees every 2 years. High population pressure, really big trees. We treated every 2 years at the medium rate and medium low rate. And by the time we were done, these were up over 50 inches DBH, but quite effective. So here's the canopy condition when we started, 2010. And what we see is that over time, the canopy condition improved. Even at this low to medium rate with triage on these really big trees, we treated them for 3 cycles and evaluated them over a 6-year period. Very effective, the biggest trees that we could find. Back to the wounding. So we saw the slide earlier showing the kind of wounds that injections can make. This shows a study published by Dave Smitley at Michigan State. And a study published by Deb McCullough and her student Sarah Tannis, looking at compartmentalization. And so something to keep in mind is that ash is a ring porous tree, which means that the functional xylem is very thin, 1 or 2 rings. It means it's easy to girdle and kill if you're an insect or with a chainsaw. But these interior rings are not functional when it comes to moving water. And each year, the tree is putting down another ring. And so within a few years, you know, these wounds become compartmentalized into non-functional xylems. So here's a current year wound, but here's one that's compartmentalized a couple years more. So the question we get is, if you're treating every 2 to 3 years, what impact does it have? Well, a wound that was made 2 years ago will have 2 years of functional xylem laid on top of it. One that was treated 3 years ago, of 3 years, if you're treating every 3 years, the second round, 6 years back, is going to have a pretty nice, if it's a healthy tree, be compartmentalized, you know, functionally pretty deep in the tree where it's just not interfering with water. translocation. They didn't see any evidence of internal decay, but caveat, you know, these studies have not been done over the long term. So, you know, what will be the long-term effects of this wounding kind of remains to be seen, but it looks like ash trees, healthy ash trees, compartmentalize these wounds well. You can treat maybe when the infestations are low, treat with soil treatments, move back to soil treatments after the wave passes and treat, you know, for a few cycles. You know, there's various strategies that you can do, treat for a few cycles with injections while the populations are really high. So key conclusions, the trunk injections really effective on large trees, soil treatments on, we've tested on trees up to 23 inches, but probably effective on trees larger than that. Use the 2x rate on the larger trees. Spring treatments are more effective than fall. Dinotefuran soil and basal bark sprays are equivalent. Ivermectin benzoate provides 2 years of control on large trees, even at the lowest rate, 3 years of control. And triage is more effective than the imidacloprid's. Triage and the imidacloprid soil drench were more effective than the pointer in the head-to-head studies. Timing, obviously you want the insecticide to be in the tree before the insects begin feeding on it. So you can target adults, get some impact, but adults are also moving around, so you want to control larvae. You want the tree to be toxic to larvae before the eggs hatch. And so you need to allow adequate uptime, 3 or 4 weeks with the soil treatment, less time for the trunk injection. The imidacloprid becomes much less effective on larger larvae, so treatments into the summer are not effective with the trunk injections. Weather conditions often are not as favorable, plus larvae have already been damaging the tree. So ideally, you treat it in the spring. If you find a tree that just comes to your attention in the summer, can treat fall treatments. And by fall, I mean after September 21st, after the leaves have dropped. There is some work with trunk injections to see if they might be effective. I'm not familiar with the results of those studies, but we really, ideally, you would treat before in the spring, before the insects begin feeding. In Ohio, Kentucky, and Michigan, black locust is blooming when emerald ash borer adults emerge and begin feeding. So if you're targeting adults, you want to allow uptake and translocation before black locust blooms. And if you're treating larvae, you can add another, you know, 2 weeks or 3 weeks on that because of maturation feeding and then eggs being laid. And then probably another 2 weeks after that to get peak egg laying and egg hatch. So banded ash clearwing borer. So this can be a problem on stressed ash trees, even if you're treating for EAB with imidacloprid, because imidacloprid is not effective against caterpillars typically, and it's not effective against banded ash clearwing. So you can still have problems with this in stressful sites, even if you're getting control of EAB, if you're using imidacloprid. So we tested ivermectin benzoate, found that we got 2 years of control of the banded ash clearwing borer with ivermectin benzoate, equivalent to spraying the trunk with Onyx, which is kind of an industry standard, a formulation of permethrin that's particularly effective on the bark of trees. And imidacloprid was not effective. Here's the control. This is the amount of frass being spit out of the tree, so it's kind of an index. So this high bar means there's a lot of insect activity. These low bars mean very low insect activity. Just one misconception I want to mention. You still see this in newspapers and so forth, that tree removal will somehow slow the spread of EAB. These are quotes from newspaper articles and so forth. And removing healthy trees will not slow the spread of EAB. Models suggest it will hasten the spread of EAB because larvae or adults fly farther looking for trees to lay their eggs on. If you remove and destroy infested trees and you kill the insects by destroying the trees, that can have an impact. If you're aggressive and populations are low, that can delay the rate at which population growth occurs. But this is a misconception that I wish would go away, that cutting down healthy trees will slow the spread of EAB. As far as the economics of treating, so studies have shown that the probability that a tree in a, on a street is going to get big is low. The economic value of trees increases exponentially with the size of the tree. You can model and calculate that with iTree, for example. And so what are the economics of treating these large trees rather than removing? And some studies have been done on that. The study, for example, found that it's cost effective to treat large trees, especially when you factor in the ecosystem, the economic benefits of ecosystem services like stormwater management, air pollution mitigation, carbon sequestration, air conditioning benefits, and so forth. Cliff Sadoff and his colleagues published a really nice paper in Arboriculture and Urban Forestry where they really analyzed the economics of treatment versus removal. And this paper is available. You can freely available at the website. You can download it and read it. And I'm not going to go through their results except to show that treatment can be very economical in many situations. And these cost versus benefits can be analyzed using the Purdue Cost Calculator at this website. And so this is a way to model the costs and benefits of treatment versus removal. And you can enter user-defined parameters for size of tree, cost of removal, cost of treatment, and so forth. And you can model different scenarios of removing some trees, treating some trees, treating all trees, treating no trees, treating trees for a while, then not treating again. And if you have an inventory on your number of size of ash trees, and you have an estimate of the cost of removal and the cost of treatment, then you can, this model is very user friendly to generate these projections. And you can do things like figure out the cost of doing nothing. We know trees will die exponentially and very rapidly after a lag period. You can use insecticides that are effective enough to, you can stabilize mortality at a certain level. You can delay mortality so that your tree removal crews can keep up, can prevent mortality altogether, except some trees will die from lightning or some other reason, or like ours did in our backyard from the septic guy that came and dug up our yard. But you can bend this mortality curve to any shape that you desire using insecticides, and using the cost calculator, you can model what you want this shape to look like and plan out into advance the costs and benefits of these various strategies. Finally, just a word about bees. There's very justifiably so concerns about systemic insecticides and bees, imidacloprid. Well, first of all, ash is a dioecious species, so they're separate male and female plants, and ash is pollinated by wind. So the female trees don't produce nectar, the male trees produce pollen, and ash or bees have, you know, been documented collecting pollen from ash trees. It occurs just over a couple of days. And imidacloprid can move in to pollen. Those studies suggest maybe not at levels high enough really to have an impact. But I personally have never seen bees foraging on ash trees. Here's one of our study sites and had an apiary right next to it. And there's a lot of stuff in bloom when ash trees are flowering that are bee pollinated and are very attractive to bees as well. But nonetheless, they can collect pollen, and we did all our treatments after they were done flowering. This was that study site in Toledo with imidacloprid, and still got really good control. So you can just wait until after they flower, then treat. Reed Johnson gave a webinar recently that they didn't find emamectin benzoate in the pollen. He suggests the molecule is just too big. to move into the pollen of ash trees, and so may not be an issue. More work is required, but emamectin benzoate can also be applied the year after the trees flower. And studies have shown that there's very little emamectin benzoate in the foliage in the second year. So it probably means there's very little in the pollen the second year, or maybe it just is not able to get in there. So probably not a real risk with emamectin benzoate or with imidacloprid if you just wait until the trees flower. In this peer-reviewed document, Jeff Hahn and Deb McCullough and I address these various non-target issues associated with EAB insecticide treatments. This is available freely. You can download it for your own information or distribute it to clients. We address all these various questions. We've had this peer reviewed by water quality experts, beekeeping experts, et cetera, et cetera. And then much of what I talked about is outlined in this bulletin that we are currently revising now for a third edition that hopefully will be out maybe this, this spring. With that, I just want to echo Tom's plea to please support the Tree Fund. It's supported my research. It's been really important. I was able to leverage Tree Fund funding for my EAB research into multiple times that amount of money from federal grants. The Tree Fund grants show evidence that the industry values the work. The funding is very important, and again, it can be leveraged. So, with that, I thank you for your attention, and I'll be happy to answer questions for those of you that want to stick around for that. Thanks, part Dan. Of the, yep.
Thank you. Depending on how you feel, you can either stop sharing your screen and then we can launch into the questions. Tom and I have been monitoring the Q&A window, and he has some questions that are queued up and ready to go. So we have still 500 people with us in the meeting room, and 33 questions. So we'll try and get through them as quickly as possible. And thank you for a great presentation.
You're welcome. Thank all of you for your attention.
Thank you, Dan. So there were a lot of questions, or some of the questions were addressed as your webinar progressed. So that's good. And I'll start out with the first question, which came from Greg up in Illinois. And he had a question. I thought it was interesting. He says, as you go through the curve and the trees become, the mortality rate has progressed and the pressure of the insects are down, can the rate, the occurrence of using triage on the tree, can you extend out that 3-year cycle for longer?
That's a really interesting question. I don't know that the answer to that. It's certainly something that I believe is being researched. It's plausible.
Sorry to put that up on the screen. I just wanted to have people take the poll really quick before they leave. So if you want to minimize it, go ahead and minimize it, but just wanted to put that up there for folks.
Okay. So yeah, a good question. I don't know the answer to that.
Okay. And another question, there are some people on this webinar from Canada, and do you have any information that's specific to Canada, or is what you found in the U.S. holding true in Canada?
Well, Canada is a really different country with very different regulations, obviously. And so the pesticide regulations are different. Azadirachtin has been used extensively in Canada. In different areas. I don't have any real direct experience with azadirachtin. We tried it in one trial. My understanding is if you start treating early and when trees are healthy, that and you treat every year, that can be an effective option. I know that some companies are pursuing registrations of other products. I believe imidacloprid and emamectin benzoate. And I may be mistaken. If there's anybody from Rainbow Tree on the webinar, if they want to tap something into the chat room, but I think I recall that Rainbow Tree may have registrations now for imidacloprid and emamectin benzoate in Canada. And so, but I would think that the results of our trials would be applicable to Canada as well. One thing to think about is areas, you know, where it's much drier and the trees grow slower, like Colorado, is a lot different than Ohio and Michigan, where we have more rainfall, the trees grow faster. So there may be differences in uptake dynamics, there may be differences in wound response dynamics. And so, you know, and a lot of these things, there could be variation due to climate, particularly drought stress index and so forth.
Thank you. Another question Brian had was, is there a maximum DBH for using imidacloprid?
So the largest trees that we have tested are in that 23-inch, 25-inch range. The 1X rate in the spring was just effective as the 2-inch range. I'm not familiar with any studies that have looked at trees larger than 25 inches. But the fact that the 1X and the 2X both worked, and you can use the 2X, suggests that you can treat trees larger than 25 inches effectively. But I don't know what the maximum size would be.
Okay, and Helen asks, do we know the effect of introducing the parasites on, does it have effect on native insects, or has that been studied?
That's a really good question, and they are required to study the potential non-target impacts of these parasitoids before they're released. And so they did some studies showing that and that those are published. Those are available and published in the environmental impact assessment for EAB biocontrol agents. Pretty easy to find that online if you Google EAB biological control environmental assessment. That they concluded that the risk was minimal, that they were either specific to the species, were either specific to EAB, or they were specific to ash trees. So I don't have any direct experience or research myself on that. I just know what I've seen reported in the assessments, and I guess I'll leave it at that. It's a good question.
Another question, I think you touched on it a little bit, but Jeremy asked if your studies were done on multiple species of ash?
We have done studies on green ash and white ash. Those are the two that we've worked with. So we've used the cultivars that are planted on street trees. and it's hard for me to know what those cultivars are that were planted 20 years ago. But white ash and green ash are what we have done our studies on. And I think that's pretty much the case with, I'll say we also did a study with blue ash. I didn't report on that, but it was also effective on blue ash as well. So those are the three species. We haven't done anything with black ash, and I don't know if anybody else has either.
Okay, Dan, and then one question that was asked more than once, and I think we understood it, but when you refer to 2X or 2 times,
yes.
Do you mean double the dose or do the dose twice a year?
I mean double the dose, double the rate. So you treat once a year, but you double the rate. Yeah, good question. I should clarify that point when I give that presentation. So double the dose. So the amount that you apply per inch of trunk diameter. And the labels are pretty clear on that. If you just read the label, there'll be the label will specify what can be allowed, what's allowed for ash and emerald ash borer versus other pests. So it'll be right there on the label for products that are labeled for shade trees. And then there's also limitations on how much you can apply per acre for those soil applied insecticides. So if you're treating a number of trees in a small site, you need to be concerned about the per acre limitations as well.
And there's a probably a final question now. We're over our hour, but Stephen had a question. It's somewhat political, but he asked, Dan, what are your thoughts on APHIS proposed changes to redirect funds away from quarantine regulation toward biological control.
Yeah. Well, so, I mean, it'd be ideal if there was enough funding to do everything. I think the quarantines have been very effective at slowing the spread. We're not finding nursery stock being moved. We're not finding logs, things being moved in commerce. I think public education hopefully has helped with firewood. The reality is that emerald ash borer is going to continue to spread around the country, and hopefully biocontrol can eventually have some positive impact on the restoration of ash back to the ecosystem. So how's that for a politically correct answer?
Hey, Dan, I've read a couple questions. Unfortunately, we still have 46 more questions, and there's no way we're going to get through those. But would you be willing to make the slideshow available?
Yes.
A lot of people wanted to take a little closer look at the graphs. I mean, the recording will be available for future viewing, but I think maybe just the slideshow would be helpful too.
Yeah, you can post that. And, you know, when I was at Ohio State, I had a website with all my presentations posted on that, but when I left, they took it down.
Okay, yeah, no, we can put it on our website, and I'm sure Tree Fund could probably do the same. Yeah. Should we wrap up, or do you want to take a few more questions? It's totally up to
I'm
you.
I'm happy to answer questions if people want to stay around. And
all right, maybe five more minutes. Does that sound good?
That's fine with me.
Okay, go ahead, Tom.
Another easy, quick question. Can you, the webpage for the cost calculator, what should one Google to get to that webpage?
Okay, so that URL is listed on that slide, and I don't remember what it is. Let's see if my screen's not shared anymore. But so the website will be, or the presentation will be posted on the Tree Fund. But actually, I found it by Googling EAB Purdue Cost Calculator. So if you just Google that, it'll be the first thing that comes up. But the URL will be on the slide, and the slide will be in the presentation posted by the Tree Fund.
Another one, and I'm not sure whether it's been researched or not, but Brian had a question about how far in advance should trees be treated before the insect is identified in the area?
Yeah, so that's a kind of a tricky question, because you're balancing risk versus, you know, cost. If you're treating ahead of time, you're wasting money. If you start too late, you might lose a tree, but trees can tolerate low levels of infestation. And if you know how to detect, you can see signs of infestation before the canopy starts showing decline. And so we, in our bulletin, when I was with Ohio State, in our multi-state bulletin, we finally settled on, you know, begin treating when EAB has been detected within 15 miles of your location. And that might be too liberal if you're, you know, a site like in Nebraska where the infestation is still really small and it's going to spread slow. It's a little more conservative where you're in Ohio where the wave is spreading very rapidly. But if you know, if you wait too long, the control may not be effective. So I guess it depends on what the client's appetite for risk is versus their willingness to spend money. But we use 15 miles as a rule of thumb.
Danielle had a question, and you addressed it partially, but maybe some clarification on it. You said to destroy the tree after it's taken down if it's been infected. And the normal way that arborists do that is with chippers. But has it been shown that the EAB, that the emerald ash borer, can stay alive in chipped wood?
Well, in theory, a pre-pupa could survive in a chunk of wood that's large enough to contain the pre-pupa in the wintertime. It's done feeding, and so the regulations say that ash wood should be chipped to a size of no greater than 1 inch in any two diameters or any two directions. So, but for practical purposes, you know, unless you're shipping beyond quarantine zones where you have to do that to make it deregulated, chipping will have a, you know, substantial impact on the population in the tree. So, you know, if you're looking at suppressing a population in an area where it's still low, I think just routine chipping will do the job. It may not kill every single one, but you're not going to get every single one either, because it's so hard to detect at low levels. It's always, you're chasing shadows. It's always farther out there than you think, which kind of gets back to, yeah, maybe you need to be 15 miles out from the closest point of detection.
Lots of great questions. I wish we could get to all of them, but let's take one last question from Bob up in Cincinnati. And he had a question about two-year treatments with triage, which is currently what they have been doing. Would it be recommended to stretch that out to 3 years on healthy trees?
Yeah, I think you can. I think that data now are very, very much support that you can go to 3 years effectively. Maybe the exception is if you're treating 40 to 50 inch trees. You know, that I don't like to extrapolate beyond the data. And, you know, for trees in that 20, 30 inch range, we have good data for the three to support the 3 year. But for trees in that 40 to 50 inch range, we have good data to support 2 years, and maybe you can get away with three, but I know scientists tend to be pretty cautious about extrapolating beyond the data points.
Okay, Dan, thank you very much. And to all the participants, thank you for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you. I really appreciate it. And please make sure to take the poll. It looks like you guys are all doing a good job of that. And I'll send an email out when the video is posted. I'll send an email if you're okay with your email, Dan, because we still have 44 questions that didn't get answered.
Want to email me, I will just say that my wife and I are going out of the country on vacation on Saturday, and so I may not be able to respond for maybe 2 weeks. So if you don't get a response right away, I will respond.
Great. Have a good vacation.
Well, thank you.
Thanks, everybody, for participating today. Thank you, Karen. Have a wonderful day. And check your email inbox, and I will send an email when all of these things are posted. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody.
Thanks.